Hello and welcome to this section on recurrent neural networks, or RNN. In the previous section, we have seen how CNNs work, or convolutional neural networks work, and how they are used for image recognition. In this section, we are going to talk about RNN and its applications. So as always, I will take you through a brief introduction of recurrent neural networks, and then we will dive straight into the code and demos. We will start initially with how RNN is implemented in TensorFlow 1.x, and then I'm going to show you how the code is written in TensorFlow 2.0. RNNs are used where sequence is required. For example, in the previous section, we talked about image recognition. When you're trying to classify an image, or when you're trying to detect an image or object, the sequence doesn't really matter. But there are situations where the sequence matters. For example, if you take a look at this sentence, can you make any sense out of this? They are a bunch of words, but they don't make any sense. On the other hand, if we change the sequence of these words, it makes a whole lot of sense. For example, this is a proper sentence saying, can this be solved while ignoring the sequence of words? So wherever there is a need for processing which requires sequence, that is where other neural networks like CNN fail, and we will be using, or we need to use, recurrent neural networks. Let's take another example. Let's consider sentiment analysis. Whenever a sentence is formed, or when we hear a sentence, our brain processes it and we form a sentiment, like a positive sentiment or a negative sentiment, or sometimes a neutral sentiment for that particular sentence. And how does our brain process this? It actually takes the entire sentence and then it forms a sentiment about it. Let's try to do this word by word. I'll bring up one word at a time and see what kind of sentiment is formed in your brain. Let's start with the first word, which is I. This is a neutral sentiment. Can't. That's a negative sentiment. And together with these two words, the sentiment of the sentence is still negative. Let's take our third word. I can't find. Find is a neutral, but overall, the phrase is still negative because it says I can't find. Let's move on. The next word is any. Once again, this is a neutral sentiment, the word. Therefore, overall, the phrase still has a negative sentiment because it says I can't find any. Now, let's go to the last word, which is flaw. Now, it's interesting that flaw by itself is a negative word, but when read in the context of the other words, the whole sentence actually becomes positive. Till the previous word, the sentence was carrying a negative sentiment, but now all of a sudden becomes a positive sentence because it says I can't find any flaw. Situations like this where sequence matter, we need to use RNN. So what is RNN, or what is recurrent neural network? This is a quick diagram. On the left hand side, you see a regular neuron, which is a part of a regular neural network. In this case, we have seen there is an input and there is an output. Of course, there can be multiple inputs, but then you feed the input and you get some output. It's like one way. Compared to this, in case of RNN, the output is fed back as an input. So that is primarily the difference between a regular neural network and a recurrent neural network. So you can see here, there is XT, which is a regular input, but then there is also this loop that is shown here, which is kind of the output is being fed back into the neuron. And then, of course, there is an output component here. So this is the basic difference between a regular neuron and an RNN. And that is why this is known as recurrent, because you are feeding back the output as an input. Now, sometimes it is difficult to represent this, and therefore we resort to this kind of a representation. On the left-hand side is a recurrent neuron, and on the right-hand side is what is known as a rolled-out version of it. Now, this can sometimes get confusing, but this is actually a single neuron. It's the same neuron, but its state is represented at different time frames, if you will. So this is at time t0, this is at time t1, t2, and so on. So this entire thing is actually a single neuron shown at different time intervals. So this is the representation of a RNN, and then when you have multiple neurons, the same thing, instead of single neuron here, we show multiple neurons, and then same way, it can have multiple layers as well. So this is another representation of an RNN which has multiple neurons, like in this case. And this can be extended when there are multiple layers as well. Keep in mind, these are not multiple layers. This is a single layer of multiple neurons, and these are representations at different times. This is the output at t minus 1, with input xt minus 1, and then this is the output at t with input xt, and then this is the output at t plus 1 with the input xt plus 1. Now, there are different types of RNNs based on the requirement, what we want to achieve, and what is listed here is the different types of RNN. The first one is a one-to-one, or what we call as a vanilla RNN, where you feed in one input and you get one output. A very simple example is price prediction. When you want to predict stock price, you feed the input, which is the stock price, maybe historical information of the last 1 year, and it will predict the price once again of the future. So it is just one value, the price, which you're feeding in and you're getting out as price. Then there are situations where you provide one input and you get multiple outputs. Image captioning is one such example. So the input is an image and the output is a phrase or a sentence. Then you have many to one, where you provide multiple inputs and you get one output. The most common example is sentiment analysis. You feed a sentence which consists of multiple words or a sequence of words, and you get a sentiment which is just one value. It can be 0 or 1 very often. So it's a positive sentiment or a negative sentiment. So that is an example of many to one. And then you have many to many, which again has a couple of variations. In this simple many to many example, you feed in multiple inputs and you get multiple outputs. The most common one is translation. So you feed in sentence in a particular language and you get the output again as a sentence, which consists of a sequence of maybe words in a different language. And then you have situations where you need to delay the output. It could be like captioning of a video. So these are different types of RNN based on how they are applied. And where are RNNs applied? What are some of the applications? Speech recognition is the most common area, and it requires a sequence. And that's why speech recognition is one of the most common applications. And then any other requirement which needs a sequence, like time series data, that's where RNNs are used. And of course, also for text analytics and NLP, or natural language processing, which again is actually a component of speech recognition. Because the way speech recognition works is, speech is converted to text and the text is analyzed using natural language processing and then converted back to send it to the user in the form of speech. So we are going to take a look at some of these examples in the form of code, in the form of demos. I will take you through a few examples of text classification and some examples of time series analysis as well. So before we go into the demo, let's take a quick look at a couple of variants of RNN. Now, one of the issues with RNN, or there are a couple of issues, both related, are vanishing gradient and exploding gradient. Now, these are common problems in neural networks in general, but they get amplified due to the structure of RNNs. So if we have a deep neural network where there are actually multiple layers, by the time the error propagates from the output towards the input, sometimes it can become zero if the gradient is very low. This is known as vanishing gradient. And the opposite of that could be that the gradient is very high, and then if it gets multiplied, it can, by the time it goes through multiple layers, it can become a very large number. And this is known as exploding gradient. In order to overcome these problems of vanishing gradient and exploding gradient, there are a couple of variations of the basic RNNs, and these are LSTM, which is the short form for long short-term memory, and then we have GRU, or gated recurrent unit. So this is how LSTM cell looks. We'll not get into all the details of this, but here there are a couple of additional components. There is one which is like the state, which kind of continues through the various, the whole, let's say, the time sequence, and this prevents the output or the gradient from vanishing. And then there are a forget gate and an update gate, which takes care of removing stuff that is not required. So that's how the name comes, forget gate. It deletes portions of information that are redundant. And then at each level, there is an update gate which kind of adds new information. And then you have the final output. And then we have the gated recurrent unit, which is another variation of LSTM, and it is kind of a simplified version of LSTM. So both of these variations are used in order to overcome the problems with the basic RNN. As far as the code is concerned, there is not a large difference. It is just a simple API call, and you specify what kind of RNN, whether you want to use basic RNN or LSTM or GRU, but the rest of the code remains the same. With that, let's get straight into the code. As a first step, what I'm going to demonstrate is the implementation of a basic RNN cell. So this consists of one neuron, and this is very similar to what we did in the neural network section, where we implemented a perceptron, basic perceptron. So in this case, it is a recurrent RNN cell. So I'm going to show you in the code how to implement this basic RNN cell. There are the number of neurons is one, number of inputs we will start with one, and number of steps, time steps, we will start with two. And this is how the RNN cell would look. I will show this again in the next video when I'm going to show you the code demo as well.